Hello everyone!
In this tutorial, I will teach you how to write a property-based testing library from scratch.
In our case, in the Elm language. Don't worry, it will be easily translatable to other languages though. The only thing you will need from your host language will be a pseudorandom number generator, PRNG for short, that you can seed with a specific value and get deterministic results back. Same seed in, same output out. You will need to be able to generate integers and floats in this way. First, let's quickly talk about what property-based testing is. If you already know this, feel free to skip forward to this time on the screen or using the timestamp links in the description. The basic difference between property-based testing and unit testing is that in unit tests, you usually provide and hardcode specific examples, specific inputs that you want to test, and then do something about them. Whereas in property-based tests, you describe what kind of input you want to test, for example, pairs of integers or a string of length at most 5, and the computer generates the values for you randomly. It also usually generates more than one of them, potentially a lot of them. And whenever a value is found to fail the test, the property-based testing libraries usually have some kind of shrinking mechanism to find a smaller value or a simpler value, really as simple as possible, that still fails the test. This is out of necessity. The randomly generated values can get pretty large pretty fast, and parts of those values might be totally irrelevant to your failing test. Shrinking tries to throw away all the unnecessary detail and keep only the true cause of the failure. One anecdote I recall is that the company Ericsson, one of the pioneers of the property-based testing really, wrote a property-based test that found a sequence of 160 operations that failed the test. If I recall correctly, some kind of data cache got corrupted. Link to their paper will be in the description if you want to read more. 160 operations, that's quite a lot. The shrinking process then got it down to 7 operations, resulting in the same bug. Since you as a developer have to then work with that randomly found input and make some sense of it, I think you will agree with me that looking at 7 instructions would be a much less daunting task than looking at 160 of them. We will be basing our library on the ideas from the Python library hypothesis by David McIver. Why is this significant? Well, simply put, there are two schools, or families, of property-based testing tools. There is type-based shrinking, as used by QuickCheck, and integrated shrinking, as used by Hypothesis. Just as an aside, almost every property-based testing library you can find belongs to the QuickCheck branch, which is in part why I'm making this video, to make the lesser-known approach more understandable. A library using the type-based approach does the shrinking on the generated values themselves. You can think of it as a function that takes a value and returns a list of simpler values, whatever that means for the specific type. So, for example, an integer n might shrink to 0 straight away, or to n divided by 2, or n minus 1, etc. And similarly, strings might have their own function that generates smaller or simpler strings from the one you provide. Booleans will shrink to false, and so on. And because your app will most likely have types the testing library doesn't know about, you need to somehow tell the library how you want to shrink those values. Some languages, like Haskell, ease this pain by letting you automatically derive these shrinking functions, using presumably a reflection on the types, and other languages, like Elm, hide this beneath a new abstraction. In Elm, it's called fuzzer, which marries generating values and shrinking values together. So each fuzzer knows how to do both, and you combine primitive fuzzers together like a Lego to build up your values. And the library is happy because for each step in the process, it knows how to shrink that type. Now, integrated shrinking libraries, like Hypothesis, take a little bit different approach. They really have only one underlying generator, one for integers. And everything else is built on top of that. The test runner remembers all the random integers drawn from the PRNG when generating your input value, and if your test fails, the runner then shrinks that history of drawn values. Not your generated value, but that list of integers that the PRNG gave. And it tries to generate a new value using that new, modified, simplified list of integers. Let me repeat this. Integrated shrinking libraries don't shrink the generated value directly, they instead shrink the PRNG history used to generate that value. It's kind of like going back in time and rewriting history, really. Saying, no, this time the dice didn't roll to 6, they rolled to 3. And this all means the library only needs to know how to shrink a list of integers. That's all. And that becomes the goal of the library. To make that PRNG history, to make that list of integers, first of all, shorter, and secondly, smaller. So internally, such a library will have a bunch of strategies, like try to remove some numbers from the list, try to replace some numbers with 0, try to subtract 1 from them, and so on. This means, though, that the shrinking process is sensitive to how the generators will be written. If a generator for a list first draws a number to find out the length of the list, and then calls the item generator that number of times, well, that's gonna leave one number at the beginning of the PRNG history, and then a few smaller PRNG runs after that. A different way to construct a random list might be to flip a coin, with some probability corresponding to the number of items that we want to have. And if it's 1, then let's generate another item. And if it's 0, then we have ended. These lists will generate PRNG histories like 1, something, 1, something, 1, something, 0. So we have these two potential example generators and their differing PRNG patterns for the same value. Since not every PRNG history corresponds to a generated value, only some percentage of each will succeed in making a smaller value. For example, 211 might be an okay PRNG history for the first generator, but 21 will not work, since the generator will try to draw 3 random values while it only has 2 available, so it will run out. Different generators will synergize differently with the shrinker. A well-written generator will play into the hands of the shrinker. In our second example, the shrinker will easily chop off items of the list using strategies like remove a chunk of 2 or 3 or 4 consecutive items. I am saying all of this to drive home a point that the way how we construct the generators and the primitives from which the users will construct their generators will matter in terms of how successful the shrinking process will be. There definitely will be good and bad ways to write them. And this is the trade-off between the approaches. With type-based shrinking, you can say exactly how you want to shrink your types, but you have to say how to shrink the types. The library and the language might be able to relatively successfully hide the fact that you are even doing this from you. And with integrated shrinking, you don't need to provide the shrinkers at all. But you might have to be a bit more cautious about how you write your generators. Thankfully, a well-prepared standard library of these generator primitives and combinators will do wonders for keeping the user on the idiomatic path. There are more trade-offs. For example, the type-based shrinking approach that shrinks the generated values themselves sometimes has issues with the monadic bind, the and-then function, while the integrated shrinking approach is shielded from that. And there are more, but that's perhaps a topic for another video. Well, that was quite a bit of theory. I hope you're still with me. Let's dive into the code, shall we?